Anti-dirt. Thanks, I feel a lot better now. After what felt like an eternity in my comatose state, I had finally regained the ability to move and gone to the living area. With my hand on the wall for support, I felt like an old man.
Acting tough, are we? Are you still trying to play the hero even after everything that's happened to you?
Tsumi's words stung. She probably still had a grudge against me. But even so, when I collapsed in the kitchen this morning, she was the one who carried me back to my room. She was the one who gave me the antidote to neutralize the effect of the drug. The antidote is supposed to have been stored deep inside the dark little room where Enomoto had hidden. Of course, this wasn't first-hand information. Tsumi told me all this just before. At any rate, she'd abandoned me. She hadn't abandoned me. It was completely I was completely defenseless while I was out, but she didn't use that opportunity to attack me. On top of that, she was nursing me back to health. I couldn't understand Atsumi's true intentions. Ugh. Leaning against the window, I let out a sigh. Took the wristwatch from my pocket. It was 2 p.m.
It'll take at least 12 hours for the chemical to completely leave your body.
That's why Kuroko wakes up and everything's all weird. Atsumi continued standing in front of me.
You collapsed in the kitchen at 8 a.m. Now it's 2 p.m., 5 past.
Well, then that one may have been about 6 hours.
That's right. Why don't you just rest quietly until then?
You sing me a lullaby?
Don't be silly. You're probably trying to show me that I'm healthy enough to joke, right?
No, I'm serious.
Don't strain yourself.
I'm not.
Even though your face is so twisted like that.
Hey, I was born that way.
Then try squeezing my hand.
Saying that, she extended her arms out to me. Placed my hand over hers.
I asked you to squeeze it. That's just touching, right?
Even if she said that, there was nothing I could do. Fingertips wouldn't do as I told them. I was finally able to flex my fingers just enough to make a fist.
Harder.
I was in no condition to be making such fine adjustments. I'm sorry, as Atsumi said, I was just acting tough. Every muscle in my body had just relaxed as though they'd been transformed to jelly or yogurt. By putting my entire body weight against the window, I was somehow able to stay standing, but it felt like I'd fall over if something as much breathed at me. And this was 6 hours after I'd collapsed in the kitchen. Thankfully, I wasn't seeing any more of these weird visions. My body still felt completely limp.
Can we consider the handshake of a reconciliation? Don't try to fool me. If you can't squeeze it, then say so.
I kept silent. What was Atsumi thinking right now? I tried to sense her thoughts through the warmth of my hand. Of her hand. Was she still harboring murderous thoughts against Hitori?
The very same Hitori was now sitting on one of the dining area chairs chatting with Yuni.
I couldn't make out the conversations from her, but I could see them well enough. Hitori and Yuni, of course, were both safe. The anniversary of Junichi Kun's death, the 14th, had already passed. But even so, it wasn't as though Atsumi's grudge had wiped itself clean. Furthermore, even though I was currently in no condition to stop her, it looked as though she hadn't laid a hand on Hitori. Why? I had no idea what Asami was thinking. However, it looked as though she felt the same.
I have no idea what you're thinking.
She shook her head as though flustered and gently released my hand. Hey, who was it that made Kokoro take that drug? I asked as I clumsily rubbed my numb.
I have no idea, it's not like I saw it happen.
Could she have taken it herself?
Could she have taken it herself?
Kokoro did.
There was an empty bottle on the kitchen floor. If someone had forced her to take it, they would have taken the evidence with them, right?
I don't think that's necessarily the case. Well, whatever. Can think about that later.
And what kind of drug was inside the bottle? I still don't know the details. That's right, I haven't told you yet.
Glancing discreetly over at Hitori, Tsumi opened the door to the terrace. She stepped outside. Maybe she didn't want Hitori to hear? I followed after it saw me. The sky was refreshingly clear. There was no wind, and the sun hanging in the western sky threw bright sunlight down at us. Despite the fact that I was in my pajamas, I didn't feel that cold. But then again, that could have more to do with my paralyzed nerves than my actual temperature. The cold air felt invigorating against my dulled body. There are actually two empty bottles. Tsumi said as our exhalations turned to white vapor.
One bottle of DMT and one more containing a solution of Harmine and Harmaline. Have you heard of it before, DMT I mean?
No.
DMT, dimethyltryptamine.
Okay. Dimethyltryptamine
is a substance classified as one of the most powerful hallucinogenic drugs. As for Harmine and Harmaline, you've probably heard of them before.
They're the inhibitor.
The inhibitor is the same as what they're at Radate. Yes, the chemical that killed it.
Tsunami had said it outright, but I couldn't quite wrap my mind around it. Inside my head, I could still see the rat writhing in anguish on the dining area. Why had Kokoro introduced such a dangerous drug into my body? Normally, simply ingesting DMT wouldn't be enough to cause a hallucination on its own. The oxygen from the mana-o-mine oxidation agent that naturally exists in the body acts to destroy the active ingredient DMT. It breaks down tyramine the same way, after all. However, it's a different story when it's used together with harmine and harmaline. The inhibitor suppresses that oxygenating ability, hindering the metabolism of the DMT. As a result, the hallucinogenic chemical remains in the blood. That's it. But I don't understand. What?
Anything. For the sake of the argument, let's say Kokoro really did take the medicine herself. What would she do? Why would she do that? Didn't she know it was an inhibitor when she took it? Even if she did she... What the hell? What was that? Oh, it was just the background music. I thought I clicked something accidentally. Even if she did, did she really understand how dangerous it could be? And then...
Oh, sorry. There's no use in asking you that, is there?
That might not be entirely true. I've said maybe she took it herself before, but it might be that one of the other two forced her to.
One of them? In other words, you mean it's Hori, right? She walked away from him, as though trying to evade her question. Quietly bending down, she tipped her hand into the snow collecting on the terrace.
I'm repeating myself, but I don't intend to cause you any trouble. Please understand.
I responded with a question aimed at her hunched back. Then that means you're still going to.
Are you still going to try to stop me?
She tried to kill you, you know. She removed her hand from the snow. Patting it dry, she approached me.
Even if it was Hitori who gave her the drug, you don't know whether she intended to kill me or not, right?
If she was trying to kill me, she wouldn't have needed the DMT. Besides, you told me 2 days ago, right? If you don't eat anything for 48 hours, the inhibitor won't have any effect. I haven't eaten anything in Sphere for more than 2 days now. I think Hitori knows that too.
I wonder. The girl has DID, you know. She wouldn't know anything when she's not the dominant personality at the time.
The dominant personality? Those words grab me. Hasn't only the Hitori personality appeared in Nudibushi Kaiko for the past few days?
If that's the case, then a different personality could have assumed control without my knowledge. It's the same with you.
With me?
You don't remember anything when you became Furukawa. Think about it. Instead of you, if Furukawa had signed an Aiden Furu containing Tyramine,
I would have died. That's how it is.
But I'm alive right now. What's important is whether the possibility exists. Do you know what willful negligence is?
It's a mental state in which, while not consciously intending to do any harm, careless actions can in fact result in it.
Even if there was no clear intent to kill, it might have been that you really didn't care if you did die.
That can't.
In all candor, it's a miracle that you're alive right now. It was only a coincidence that you didn't eat anything, right? Am I wrong? You should think about this very clearly.
Tsumi bent over again to scoop up more snow. She picked up a handful and flung it away, tracing its arc with her eyes. There was no wind, and a thin mist of snow drifted like a veil in the air.
It's getting colder. Let's go back.
Without waiting for my reply, Tsumi disappeared into the building, leaving me behind. I scooped up the snow just as Tsumi had. I tried to grasp it, but just as before, my fingers were completely numb. After returning to my room, I tottered over to my bed and flung myself down. DMT, the inhibitor. Did Tori make Kokoro take it? Or was it Kokoro itself? Why? To what end? With willful negligence? If that was the case, then who had willfully done it? If that was the case, incoherent thoughts flitted through my head. Last night, the man calling himself Enomoto died. The idea of Enomoto being the one who tried to kill me did pass through my mind, but the inhibitor, assuming that my body consuming it was a result of willful negligence, then just like before, it was someone trying to kill me. Was that it? If so, then there's no way the late Enomoto could have done it. That would mean there was a chance Enomoto had been completely uninvolved in the past attempts of my life. Was the true culprit elsewhere? I let out a sigh. I had to leave a message for Kokoro. Even one line would be fine. Who was it that made you take the drug? The moment I decided to do that, I went to get up. There we go. Wait, what? But that was a normal miracle child. Dense ocean current cold around me, as if to lap over my whole body. I felt as if I was being embraced by a sea teeming with coercivate. I've had this dream before. The primordial sea. I can no longer tell where my own existence begins or ends. I felt as if this whole vast sea were myself and that there was no singularity entity in existence here. My surroundings were completely saturated by a dazzling red light, a rhythmic sound, and a sweet scent that felt as if it would dissolve. I felt as though I was drowning in this comfortable warmth. Okay. Recollect. Cold. I immediately found an intense cold cutting through me. Transfer? I understood right away. I and Kokoro's body was curled up on a bed in the shelter cabin wrapped in blankets. My arms hugged my shoulders. No matter how much I willed them to, my arms, legs wouldn't stop shaking. It was already beyond shivering. I was convulsing spasmodically, my whole body trembling uncontrollably. The cold assailed me from all sides, rattling my bones and threatening to crush me. Everything in my mind, be it before the transfer, the DMT, the MAO inhibitor, was all blown away. All that mattered right now was preserving my own life. Everything else is mere luxury. I had to overcome this. That's why I wanted to. Even my blood had frozen in my veins. No oxygen or nutrients were nourishing my brain. Come on, calm down. Calm down. Think, just think. But I'm just thinking about thinking getting nowhere. Worthless. The empty thoughts watered my head. Cold. I'm gonna lose it for real if this keeps up. I was in a dangerous situation, walking the thin line between reason and instinct. I held my head and continued struggling against the unwieldy desires bugging inside me. A life or death battle. Is this when he eats the food? Because he eats the food at some point, right? Then again, there's a lot of things that are unexplained. Even though you've seen Satoru's side. Like, who took the drug? Who killed Nanamoto? Stuff like that. And before long, I felt the temperature inside the cabin rise a little, but only a little. My frozen blood slowly began to flow through my body again. The cold coiled through my spine finally loosened. It was still painfully cold, but somewhat better before. My mind, too, gained a little leeway to think. Raising my head, I looked around the room again. I felt a vision expanded. I noticed something that I hadn't been able to earlier. Yumugi, Lin, Yuni. For the first time, I realized they were all there. They were scattered around the room and shaking as though on the verge of death. If it weren't for the shivering, I'd have taken them for dead. Other than that, none of them moved in the slightest. Their pupils were dry and hollow, like clouded marbles. The breath escaping their lips was thin and frail, and shallow as though each one of them could be their last. I was struck by how much they've changed. How could they have fallen apart so quickly in only one night? I wonder what happened to them during such a short period. What's wrong? What happened? The cold may have abated, but my numbed lips wouldn't return to normal so easily. I asked them in a voice as dried out as a desert wind, but nobody said anything. Yumugi simply stared back at me with cloudy eyes. What about the stove? Did the fire go out? I crawled frantically out of the bed, confirming it. I opened the door of the stove and peered inside. Only blackened charcoal remained. How did this... What happened to the fuel? Didn't she chop the table and chair for firewood?
Yukido-kun, I presume. You can understand what's going on just by looking, can't you?
A cracked voice escaped from Yumugi's emaciating body. What's going on? I quietly looked around me. After all the firewood that had been piled up in the corner of the room was gone, only the axe leaning against the wall remained.
There's nothing left to burn. It's not like we can stop tearing down the cabin.
His voice brimmed with hopelessness. No way. I peered into the stove again. I reached a hand in to feel the charcoal, not a trace of warmth. The cinders were ice cold. 2 more days until the rescue team arrives. In this cabin, having finally run out of fuel, they would have to survive 2 more long cold nights. Can they really hold out until this? If there were at least some rations. If only there was something for them to eat somehow. That's right, the rations. You still have the rations, right?
I said, turning to face them. Yumugi answered softly. Yeah, just a little.
Where are they?
You're gonna eat them.
No, that's not it. I wanted to know how much is left.
They should be with you.
Me?
We entrusted the rations to you, Fuyukara-san.
The moment he said that, I rushed back to the bed. The bottom bunk. The blankets I'd thrown off earlier were all in place. When I pulled them back, a cylindrical object rolled into the bed. From the writing on the surface, I knew at a glance that it was a can of hardtack biscuits. I tried opening the lid. It was empty. I found nothing resembling food. Just countless crumbs all over the bed. What's this? I used a fingertip to pick one up. Crumbs of hardtack. What's wrong? I heard from over my shoulder. No, it's nothing. I frantically covered the empty can and the crumbs with a blanket as a temporary measure. I looked over my shoulder with what I hoped was a calm expression. Yamogi inclined his head suspiciously. Before he could notice what was on the bed, I quickly got up and moved away from it.
You saw her just now, right? That's all. We have nothing else left to eat.
I see. My voice sounded dangerously shrill. I intended to behave naturally, but my throat felt dry and cramped. If I kept talking to him, it'll be over. I turned away to crouch in front of the stove. The cold stove that held no flame. What the hell? The hell were you thinking, Kokoro? I screamed in my mind. I covered my face with my palms and furiously scrubbed at it. I didn't want anyone to see the face I was making. With my hands still over my face, I began to think. First, those scraps. Yamogi said that the Kokoro was one in charge of the rations, but those vital rations had vanished, leaving nothing on the crumbs. Why? No need to think about that one. Kokoro must have eaten them. Now that I think about it, I haven't felt truly hungry since I transferred.
Ooh. Interesting.
So I have two theories for this. One, someone forced Kokoro while she was in mid-transfer to eat them, which would put Yuni on the list because he's the one who knows the intervals. Another one would be, what if someone else was in Kokoro's body at the time? Like, for example, they transferred. Satoru went to go into Kokoro's body, Kokoro went into Satoru's body, but before Satoru could go into Kokoro's body, someone else went in. And then they went out, and that's when Satoru came in, but the person who'd been in already had eaten. Does that make sense? I think it's more believable that Yuni probably forced Kokoro to eat them, but I don't know. The other three are practically wasting away, but I can still move around the room. My body's the only one with energy left. Why'd you eat them, Kokoro? Was your hunger so impossible to bear that you couldn't take it anymore? Driven by instincts that had overridden your reason, so Kokoro took the rations and... But isn't that just too cruel, Kokoro? The fact that everyone entrusted the supplies to you meant that they trusted you, and you jobbed across them. I didn't know you had it in you to do such a thing. Suddenly, the events of last night resurfaced in my mind. The scene I'd witnessed in the basement. The slaughtered corpse of Enomoto. My left hand firmly clutched the bloodstained knife. Come to think of it, Kokoro is the one who killed that man so brutally. If we assume that she did that was in self-defense, then was this an emergency measure? But the law has nothing to do with this anymore. In a crisis like this, such pithy justification is no use whatsoever. Rather, because we've been driven up against the wall like this, our regard for humanity and morals needs to be much higher. Isn't that right, Kokoro? Wonder what happened to you? What changed you this much? Change? No, maybe that wasn't it. Maybe the woman called Fuyukaru Kokoro had been capable of committing such terrible acts from the very beginning. The state of that corpse went well beyond the domain of justifiable self-defense. And even then, everyone trusted you with the rations. You turned the tables on them and ate them all. The more I think about it, the less I understand Fuyukaru Kokoro. I want to believe her. I want to have faith in her. But... Kokoro, just what do I do? Gasping at straws now, I took out the voice recorder. No new messages, how discouraging. I couldn't think of anything to say to her right now. I heaved a sigh and put the recorder back. You were going to write a message, so... I checked the time on the wristwatch on my right wrist. Present time 3:15. Can't say with any accuracy what time the transfer occurred. I should be in the shelter cabin for a period of 33 minutes. What would the next transfer occur? 5 minutes from now, 10 or 15? Since the interval of time is so vague, it's pretty hard to tell. An ominous atmosphere hung over the small room. It reeked of decay that dogged off our every step. I suddenly choked. I need fresh air. Without stopping to to consider the consequences, I headed for the door.
You wanna die?
As I put my hand on the doorknob, Yamuraki uttered that single sentence. I'll come back before it gets to that. Oh, I thought it was just a white screen. and with that reply, I opened the door. Maybe he didn't even have the strength left to stand, but Yamuraki made no other way to stop me. Ugh, cleared up. A refreshing cloudless winter sky. A thin light blue film covered the sky. The sun already sinking into the west cast an intense light over everything, reflected across the vast snowfield. It spread itself across the silver powder that was surrounding me. I squinted against its brilliance. The glittering sunlight woke a memory buried within me.
It's not a personality exchange that you two are undergoing. Your personalities are what's being transferred. What's really being transferred is space. Yeah.
The space-time transfer. That's right. How could I forget something so important? This isn't Mount Akuru, we're on Asagi Island. My consciousness never leaves the Asagi Island 2012. So that means the sky I see right now is the sky seen from my Asagi Island. Of course it'd be sunny. Because the sky I saw at Sphere is the same sky I'm looking up right now. I see. That's why the temperature rose too.
Sent in the magazine I found in the room at Sphere. From the 15th until daybreak on the 17th.
The hole at Mount Akuro. The whole of Mount Akuro was in the midst of severe storm. In short, just before the transfer occurred, the shelter cabin had been exposed to an intense cold. I couldn't move right after the transfer because of the cold. I understood the situation. I've grasped the situation now. This is Awasagi Island 2012. My consciousness never jumped across time, rather an area of 110 meters in radius, with the cabin at the center, were transported to the world. Then what should be my next move? Simple. I led the three from the shelter cabin out of the circle. If I do that, then we won't be dragged into space-time transfer anymore. That means they'll all end up a year in the future. But now isn't the time to be worrying about the law of cause and effect. A life is irreplaceable. What would happen if I send them back to the Mount Akuro of 2011? Without food or fuel, it's hard to survive over a snowy mountain for very long. And for the sake of argument, even if they could hold out until the 17th, according to history, all that awaits them is a horrible death buried alive in the avalanche. No, wait. Aren't I forgetting something important? Uni. He's not the Uni of 2011. Though he may act that way, he's not. The Uni here, both in mind and body, is from the year 2012. He told me himself last night, no mistake about it. But why he lied about it, and why he returned to the shelter cabin like this in the first place? Still don't know for sure. What should I do? How long until the next transfer? Whatever the case, I'm afraid I don't have time to press him for an answer. Do I leave him alone and get everybody else out first? Ah, damn it. I've got no time to spare. Still not sure what I do, I reach for the cabin door. And boom.